Dr. Cooksley, another year is in the books. Ugh,
I know.
Knee-jerk reaction.
Successful, busy. Ooh. I think we're probably all kind of glad it's under the books because we had a lot of firsts this year, so I think we're celebrating.
Bring me through some of those firsts. Bring me up to speed.
Well, the report card is a number one thing with all the grade level benchmarks and really looking hard at how well our students are doing on those.
A new design.
Yeah, new design and way of recording. I mean, with that 1, 2, 3, 4, we're still trying to educate parents on the meaning of what that new report card, the additional information, basically, mm-hmm. And getting teachers more used to that type of grading. So feeling very good, positive attitudes about that.
Are students still getting the traditional
yep.
ABC?
Oh, yeah. That's still there from grades 3 through 12. That did not change. We just added that information for parents and mostly to help teachers, to believe it or not. It is good information for parents, but it helps us focus as educators on what it is truly our kids should know and be able to do. So that, I think, has really impacted instruction in the classroom because we are much more focused on this is what our students need to know.
Feedback from parents on the new look, the report card?
You know, not tons. Mm-hmm. We haven't got any like emails back. I haven't. Maybe the superintendent has. We did do a needs assessment survey, and anytime you give a survey, maybe you know this, but usually when you have comments, it's usually the people who are negative or have something that they don't like about it. Mm-hmm. So we have some comments about just why. Why the additional information, but not saying that, well, are they liking the additional information? So I think it's still just a point of education with some parents. It was only a couple handfuls. I mean, out of 700 parents that actually responded, when you only have about 20 comments, I say that's pretty successful.
What's another first for the year?
It's not a first that we've been doing, but what we've been doing in our PLCs, those early release days. Last year we started that and we just built that culture of collaboration. This year we took those grade level benchmarks, we put the data up on the wall. We're starting to look at that data and actually make instructional decisions based on that.
PLCs when teachers from specific grades get together and
yes.
plan?
Yep, not even just plan. It's all focused on student learning. What are our students learning? What are they not learning? What are we going to do about it if they don't? Which then maybe will segue into what's new for next year and what are we developing? And that's that question, what do we do when our students are not learning? Our district leadership team is looking really closely at those learning supports because those go along with that report card. So all this is kind of connected, if you will, mm-hmm. the PLCs with the report card and how we're responding. So I don't know if people have heard of, it's education jargon, it's called RTI. It's response to intervention. Basically, what are you going to do when students aren't learning? What steps do you have in place, processes, system-wide supports if students aren't learning? And so all year we've been working on that. We've been going to different workshops and conferences, trying to understand it better and how we might put that into work in our own school system. So we're going to have some things in place starting in the fall at each of our buildings.
How are we doing grade-wise? How are the students doing as far as testing, grades?
Well, it's interesting that you bring that up because about a week and a half ago, we got the Iowa assessment results. Mm-hmm. And I have to be very careful because the way that we are determining proficiency, that line that we all have to get above, is very different this year. So we're all used to that 41st percentile. That's gone. There is no percentile rank anymore, even though parents are going to be given that by the Iowa assessment people. It's meaningless because the state's not looking at that anymore. They're looking at a standard score. And so maybe we can actually educate the public in the future on what that looks like.
Standard score throughout the state? Or
yep,
are we still ranking ourselves among students in the state?
National standard score. So yes, we are still being compared to everybody who is taking the Iowa assessments. And where do we rank as a typical, let's say a fifth grader, how they might score, the average, the mean, and then we rank ourselves against that. So that's what they're going to determine our proficiency for our report card basically from the state this year. So it's complicated, mm-hmm. So I don't want to go into a great amount of detail because it's just going to confuse people at this point. We haven't even really given a big lesson to our teachers because it's very new and different.
Are the graduation rates in line? Are we getting the kids out in the
workforce
or the college?
Yep, those are going up, which is very pleasing. They've been working extremely hard at the high school. Todd Warnicke, who's the at-risk coordinator, is working diligently, and so is Mr. Foose and Mr. Bandy, on keeping kids in school, trying to find out what is the disconnect there, and getting those credits earned so that they can be a high school graduate. We're still missing some, unfortunately, but those rates are climbing, which means then the other rate is dropping.
Are we able to get students caught up during the summer for students who are falling behind? Is that happening?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Are there summer classes?
Not a summer school per se, but the high school is going to have, I guess, what you would call credit recovery for those students who didn't quite make it, or maybe juniors that are going to be shy of really being a true senior so they don't fall behind. Again, that is voluntary. We can't force kids to come in during summer school, but they are working with parents of those students who are maybe a little bit behind or much further behind so that they can stay with their graduating class. So that's going to happen this summer. So I believe that he's going to have two different sessions that are going to be going on. And basically, it is really just credit recovery using an online system of courses that are aligned to our high school courses.
At the beginning of the year, we had a conversation and Superintendent Ryder was with us. We were talking about some of the goals that the governor had for the state, some education reform goals.
Right.
Didn't really come through this year.
No, it didn't.
Do you adjust? Do you expect some of the same things to be talked about next year? Or how does the school react to the state saying that it wants to do something and it ultimately doesn't?
Yeah, see, that's a great question, because if we react to everything that maybe the legislature will do, and yes, we have to when it comes to funding and adjust those things, but when it comes to those policies and reforms, we're always going to be doing what's best for students. So, for instance, the third grade literacy, that RTI that we talked about, we are heavily focusing at that K-3 area. That's the right place to focus anyway. We agreed with the governor with that.
Talking about third grade reading requirements before students can go on fourth grade.
Right.
Wasn't passed by the legislature,
nope,
but you're still
not
focusing on that core K through third grade as far as reading and retention.
We are. And that RTI system that we're putting in place is going to help that. But we also, this is exciting, we're excited about it, maybe nobody else will be excited, but we hired an instructional coach for the elementary for next school year. They're going to heavily focus on literacy at the K-3 level. So this coach is going to be working with teachers and with small groups of students at times, modeling, co-teaching, looking at what best practice is, looking at small group instruction, the best way that we can get our kids there. Then if they don't, we've got our data walls again, and we're going to identify those students that need additional support, and our title teachers are going to help in the classroom. That's going to slightly adjust, but we truly believe that if they don't learn how to read early and understand what they're reading, we're going to lose them. And if you trace kids who are struggling in school and or potential dropouts, you can trace it all the way back to third grade.
How often do teachers see that students in second and third grade are having mm-hmm. trouble picking up reading? Is that a problem or not so much?
Well, I think it is, but in the current system that's in place, and it's nobody's fault, that's the way the system has been since school started. You didn't get it. Let's hope developmentally you'll grow over the summer, then that next teacher gets you and you blossom, and all of a sudden the light bulb comes on. And sometimes that happens. Developmentally, those kids, we can't say just because you're not reading at third grade doesn't mean you're never going to read. All of a sudden as a fourth grader, you can go, oh, I get it now, and it clicks for some reason. That's not 100% all the way across the line. So that's why we have to do those interventions. So in past practice, it's been, well, let's hope the next grade, because we don't believe in that early elementary retention as often because of the detrimental effects of that. So it's that balance thing. It's really hard to make that judgment so early.
So class is out. What advice do you give to parents as far as your students going to be in the house working, maybe sports, but do you give them advice? Do you tell them, hey, you know, wouldn't it hurt you to read a book over the summer? Or
it wouldn't read.
What kind of advice would you tell parents? Hey, you have your kids back.
Well, that's exactly what
the
elementary teachers say to them, is that they would even send books home if we had the money to do that. But really it is reading a book a week, a book a night. Read to your child at bedtime. I mean, that's the easiest thing. Any child who is read to, we know what the educational research says. Their vocabulary is much higher. They have more sophisticated word choices that they're making. They can read more fluently. They actually understand what they're reading when their parents read to them, or they just do a free choice. We can read back and forth, or they just read a simple story at night. It is as simple as that. I know that sounds like, Well, that would be so easy. But not all parents have necessarily the time, the inclination, or the belief that, well, I should be reading to my kids. But they should be going to the library during the summer, picking out books that really they enjoy. Although we want it to be subject appropriate for their age, obviously. But read. Just immerse yourself in what interests you, truly. That's all that it really takes.
Teachers have some time off, but you're still coming in.
Yeah.
What are you working on?
We are working on putting together the curriculum that was written this school year. Just in fact, before I came here, I was working on all the music ones. The grade level benchmarks will be in place next year. We have updated our language arts benchmarks as well as math, because that Iowa core and the Common Core now are married, and so we had to revisit that marriage, and so we've got some changes that are coming down the line. Refining those report cards again, making sure that we just want them to be aesthetically pleasing, and that's the biggest thing for parents as well, is to find what they're looking for.
Sounds like we are still getting used to some of the new things.
Yeah,
nothing major is coming our way, but we're just getting used to some of the things that we just transitioned
and
into.
And putting some good things in place for students that are struggling, and that's our big concern. And I know that there are some parents that worry about the other side of that. So we've got a spectrum over here of our struggling students, but then we've got those kids that, we always say in the classroom, they're going to be okay. They get it instantly, but they need to be challenged. And so we can't forget about both spectrums. And then we've got, of course, those kids in the middle that sometimes get forgotten. They're not in trouble. They're doing okay. But we need to challenge everybody. But again, we focus on that struggling learner because we know that everybody has the capacity to learn. And so a lot of the things that we're putting in place for next year, and buildings are still working on that, and they're going to actually provide that to the board in June, what their plans are. They're going to grow next year. The district leadership team is going to continue to look at that, to take a look at that retention. We still have some disagreements about good, bad, or indifferent about whether we should hold kids back. So that's going to be a huge discussion next year. So a lot of the same is going to happen next year. Our PLCs are going to be meeting every week, which is exciting, and our teachers actually are very much in favor of this. So parents obviously are going to have their kids home 1 hour early every Wednesday. Other than that, we're just going to continue to improve upon what our current system is in place. I don't see anything new coming down the line. We just want to continue to do what's best for students.
Okay. Dr. Cooksley, Curriculum Director at the Oskaloosa School District,
yes.
Thank you so much.
No problem.